This episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by touringplans.com. Spend less time in line and more time riding your favorite attractions. Visit touringplans.com.
My name's Bob, and I'm glad you guys are here tonight. Before making it all wound up, I want to give a big shout out to Jimmy Hoare in front. Those folks listening in tonight on the Disney Nerd Podcast. We want to welcome you all.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
The Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the magical worlds of Disney.
Hello, and welcome to show 399 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, this week it's Jimmy here. Ed is on vacation out in Florida with his wife, but it's okay because this week we have mini Ed, Quinn, which is Ed's son, and his girlfriend Liz, who are fresh back from Walt Disney World. Quinn, Liz, how are you guys going?
We're doing good. Yeah.
Yeah. Missing it. But
you're missing it already?
Yes.
We're already planning the next one.
So you guys are probably 3 or 4 days removed?
Yes. We got back on Sunday. So, yeah.
So 4 days removed. And this week I also have Melissa joining me to help me chat with these two guys about their trip. Hey, Melissa, how are you?
Hey, everyone. Looking forward to hearing about their trip.
Melissa, thank you. Thank you for joining me and helping me with this. I appreciate that. And I'm definitely looking forward to it. It'll be a really good show. I'm looking forward to chatting with Quinn and Liz about their trip. One of the great things about being a Disney nerd and listening to the Disney Nerds Podcast is living vicariously through someone else who has recently been down. So I was lucky enough because I'm connected with Quinn on my Disney experience to see all his pictures. And Quinn and Liz took a lot of pictures, which is great because that's one of the great things about PhotoPass. So give us a little breakdown of your trip, Quinn.
Sure. So we were there for 4 days. We used single-day tickets so that we weren't hopping from park to park. So it was a bit ambitious to try to get a lot in each day because that was the only day we were going to be at that park. We started out at Epcot. That was on a Wednesday. Then on Thursday, we went to the Magic Kingdom. On Friday, we were at Disney Hollywood Studios. And then on Saturday, we were at Animal Kingdom.
Did you guys get a chance to do Rise of the Resistance?
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
And what
we got lucky enough.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Neither one of you guys have experienced it before?
No.
And what's your initial thoughts?
I thought it was amazing.
Pretty incredible.
Yeah. I mean, I had watched the Star Wars movies. I mean, I am, by any like measure, I am not a huge fan, but I still could appreciate like all of the technology that went into the ride. Cause I mean, while I may not be familiar with everything, there was definitely like, as soon as you got in, you're like, wow, I'm in this ride. I'm in the story. So it was really cool.
And they do that attraction, they do a fairly good job of kind of setting up the story and following through. So you kind of, you don't really need to understand Star Wars. If you just have a basic understanding of Star Wars, they kind of, you kind of know what the story is and where it's going.
Mm-hmm. I was surprised how long the ride was from the pre-show to the pre-show ride to the post pre-show to the actual ride to the fact that when you get off the ride, you can still kind of see the last bit of a story being played out for the next Cars. It was just so lengthy, I guess.
For sure. It's not one of those things you get off and feel like, man, that wasn't quite long enough. Like a lot of attractions are.
How was your experience getting a boarding group? Were you able to get one of the park opening boarding groups or the 1 o'clock boarding group?
We were just right before the 1 p.m. So I think our number group number was 57. So that was like probably one of the last groups that they called in that morning session.
So you guys got it at 7 o'clock in the morning.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. And what was your process for that? Did y'all do it at the hotel? Did you kind of just set an alarm?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were at the hotel. We were all ready to go. But then we just sat and waited for that 7 o'clock time. And we found this thing where, like, you see all the videos that have the, like, oh, this is the tip to get it absolute. But I noticed that, like, if you pull it down, it won't refresh until you let go. So we were both on our phones holding down the screen until it hit 7 to then let go to refresh. We were lucky enough to get one, yeah.
That's great. Yep.
Did you experience that everyone in your My Disney Experience app became available and you had to click you and Liz, or was it just you and Liz that showed? I know that changed recently, so I was curious which version you had.
So we it was no, everybody was enabled, yeah. But so we had to switch up our scheduling, and I think my dad was supposed to come, but he wasn't able to, unfortunately. So he was still in our reservation group for that day at Hollywood Studios. So he showed up, I think, as a selection, so I had to unselect him just so the app wouldn't give me any feedback saying, oh, no, this person doesn't have a ticket. But we were all selected when we got to that screen.
I think that's what it does. It looks to see who has a park pass, who in your group has a park reservation for that day. I'm surprised that it didn't kick your dad out. Well, I guess he still technically had a ticket, right? So you'd probably fine.
Yeah.
It was the reservation to the park itself rather than having a ticket, I think.
But he actually still had a ticket because he canceled his trip, but he still has a ticket on file from his other trip, I think. Maybe not. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm wrong. He's had to cancel and move around so many different things over the past year. I really can't keep up anymore, but I think he still has a ticket that he needs to move around. I think he's going to move it to his November trip. So you guys got there. You used Magical Express?
We did not. So we flew into Florida the Sunday prior.
Yeah.
And we spent a few days with my parents where they're currently located in Florida. And then we drove for that, and then that morning.
That's correct. So any thoughts on the hotel? You guys stayed at Pop Century?
That's correct, yeah. So we stayed at the Pop Century. We were in the 90s building. Pretty close to where the elevator puts you off. So even though we were on the fourth floor, it wasn't too bad because we were like four doors down from the elevator. The walk was, I guess, nice because it might have been a bit far from the Skyliner hangar, but it was a nice walk, you know, get you warmed up in the morning. But we were also close to where the bus stations were, so that was also nice.
Yeah, we either took the Skyliner or the buses to the parks in the morning and then come back.
How were the lines for the Skyliner and the buses?
The Skyliners weren't too bad. When we got in and we checked in our luggage, we went on the Skyliner and had to wait a bit for the Epcot line to start putting people towards Epcot.
Yeah.
But on the morning of Hollywood Studios, we had to wait for the Skyliner to start. We were there that early, but once it started, it was pretty quick.
Was that your first experience on the Skyliner?
Yes.
I mean, I thought we, the engineer and us, we were kind of nerding out over how they actually get those cars, you know, go from one place to the other and then turn around, you know, switch directions. But it was definitely a very, like, peaceful ride, definitely in the morning, like you're waking up. They have these little windows and air vents, so it wasn't like it was too hot or anything. But definitely if you get into a Skyliner pod that doesn't have the character wrap on it, it's definitely easier to see out of the windows.
Absolutely.
If people are interested in taking photos from them.
I will say that at night it's a bit spooky because everything's pitch black and there's no real, like, lights to see anything next to the Skyliner poles when you're traveling between the like not over the resorts, but like over the wetlands. Yeah. So.
And We're, then the, when they kind of land you at each of the, like, I guess the depots, stations, you know, as you're going between, there is kind of a swing, but you think it's going to hit the car in front of you, but it, it doesn't. Like well, you're totally,
sometimes it does.
You're totally fine. Yeah.
So it has happened a couple of times, but no, yeah, that's true. Were they sitting you with other parties or was it just the two of you in a car?
It depended. It, in the morning when we
it
went,
only happened
yeah,
in
the morning when you're going to the park, it was more likely you're going to be seated with other people.
And I think that was only from the central station that went to either Hollywood Studios or Epcot, or back to the Pop Century and Art of Animation. It was never from the Pop Century station that we were put with people.
Well, that station at Caribbean Beach, which is the main hub, tends to. Lines tend to pile up a little more there than anywhere else, so that's probably why is they're trying to just move more people because everybody, you know, from the resorts, everybody piles into that spot and then goes to their resort, goes to the parks from there, and then opposite on the way home. So, but overall, you felt like it was a good experience. Did you guys have any issues with the Skyliner?
There was, I think, it stopped at one point before, but we couldn't discern if it was because of high winds or just because of delays and trying to get somebody on, but we didn't really, we were lucky enough. There was a big thunderstorm that hit us, but that was our Magic Kingdom day. So we were taking the buses anyway. So we were lucky not to have to rely on the Skyliner on those days.
Your first day in the parks, you went to Epcot. So you took the Skyliner and went in through International Gateway.
Correct.
Did you guys go straight up to the front at that point, or did you go in the World Showcase?
We, I guess, treated it as a normal rope drop, so we went right to Test Track.
Okay.
And it was funny because as we were walking, I started seeing people come from the other direction. It's like, where are they coming from? It's like, oh wait, the normal entrance, because it didn't click until I started seeing people pass. But yeah, we made our way to Test Track. Because I guess that's right now the big ride in Epcot that you would rope drop. I know things will change in the next year, but right now that's all they really have.
And you hadn't been in a while, Quinn. What was your thoughts about that front section of the Future World section of Epcot?
It's different. I can still remember where some things are. Some of it it's hard to remember because it's just not there. We did take a chance to stop in the one pavilion that had the preview for the changes for Epcot to come, and I'm really excited for what's coming.
I think overall it's going to be very, very nice, but you're right. It is so different because now from the front, like when you walk in, I haven't walked in the front entrance in too often over the past year because we've been at – I've been four or five times since COVID, but it seems like we've been in a Skyliner resort most of the time. So we've really utilized International Gateway. But coming from the front, now when you come in from the front and you go to the right of Spaceship Earth, it takes you over to the Coral Reef, which is interesting because that was never like that before. You really passed all that up and almost had to come back to it. And, you know, nothing else was there. Like Coral Reef was in its own little corner. And now it's kind of on the way to everything.
Yeah. I think I didn't learn until it was too late, I guess, that when the Skyliners are operating, they don't have bus services from the Pop Century. So we found ourselves at Spaceship Earth in the front of the park when we were taking our break from the day to go to our room and all that. And we had to go to the Art of Animation and walk over. But that was also a good experience because that was my first time at the Art of Animation. So,
if you're staying at Pop, it's definitely worth the little bit of time to go kind of see the lobby and walk around Art of Animation a little bit because it's such a it's a very cool resort.
Mm-hmm.
So, what else did you do that day at Epcot?
So, we made sure to hit some of the other rides. We went on Mission Space. My dad told me, "Oh, try the green side because the orange side will be pretty busy." But I guess after everybody's going Test Track or Frozen. The orange side wasn't too bad as either. But so I guess I feel like I've seen the new movie that they put in for the green side before. So I wasn't really missing out on that. But from there, we went to the Land Pavilion, and we went on the Living with the Land ride and Soarin'.
Liz, you've been to Disney before, right?
No, never.
Oh, this was your first trip?
Yes, that's why it was ideal to go with the Disney nerd.
That's fantastic. Actually, the last week of May, we just went with my son and his girlfriend. Actually, that was her first trip too. So it was. I love going. I know Quinn felt like Superman, basically, like Disney nerd Superman, when you go with the first timer and you know all these little details that you can show and point to and tell stories about. So, what did you think of Mission Space?
Yeah,
I didn't like that one as much because I got very it wasn't like it was a bad ride. I think it was I was a bit unexpected to like how claustrophobic it would feel and kind of the doing the orange side, like the fact that it spins you. I hadn't been on a spinning ride in a while, so I felt like while I didn't get sick or anything, it did feel a little like disorienting after. Afterwards, I was like, I don't think I want to ride the green side.
I think, and you know, I'll be honest with you, I think everybody gets a little disoriented. My wife gets sick on it. She gets motion sick. She does not like to ride it. I think everybody gets a little disoriented. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know for that part of it if the green side is any better. Because it doesn't spin and doesn't give you the G-forces, but you're still kind of rocking back and forth, and you're still in that tight space. So I don't know if the green side's any better for that aspect. What do you think, Melissa?
Yeah, it's not one of my favorite rides for the reason Liz pointed out. I think it's a really fun idea. I love the concept of it, and I want to like it, but it feels like my brain is sloshing around in my head when I get off of it. So I know what you mean.
I the nerd in me loves the fact that it's pretty much like what, you know, NASA astronauts go through. It's like part of that training. So it does kind of prep them for that. So all that stuff is very, very cool too. Liz, what did you think about Test Track?
Test Track was interesting. I like the concept of like being able to build your own car. I felt like, I don't know. I can't remember whose car did better, mine or Quinn's at the end of it. I feel like mine did.
I'm pretty sure it was Liz's car. So they are doing that. They are doing that again where you build your car?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's good to know.
They queue you up into the room and you – for us, they had initially kind of – they put us on the same – it seemed like they were putting couples on the same like pod.
Usually they do.
But I think – yeah, but I think you could be separate.
Yeah, so for us, it was a weird situation because the pod space in front of us was like blocked off. They had the carpet over the number. But when we went into the room itself, the monitor was fine.
Hmm.
So I was able to actually make my own car as well.
That's good to know because, I've done that before in previous trips, but the last few trips I've been on since COVID, you know, a lot of those pre-shows were not open. So you would just kind of walk through that room and didn't get to do that aspect of it. And I'll let Melissa respond to this too, but I think the previous version of Test Track was much better than the current version as far as just the story. And Liz, you probably don't know, but the original version was like it was a test track. Like you were going through a testing, like a GM, General Motors testing facility, where they tested the brakes without ABS, with ABS. You went through hot and cold and so it was like you were going through an actual test of a car.
Yeah, I think that it fit better the theming with Epcot, that it was somewhat educational, right? You got to see what it was like. It made sense with the brand who was sponsoring. And now I just kind of get a feeling like it's this mashup of trying to be Tomorrowland, trying to be GM, trying to be Tron a little bit too. Like it for just sure. is a little it half-hearted in too many directions.
I agree. What's your thoughts, Quinn?
I guess maybe there were some of the negatives from that testing experience. You probably want to away from.
I mean, look, the original idea was there for a long time, so I think it was. I think it started to get dated. Actually, I just posted a picture in the group not too long ago of my wife when we went on our honeymoon in 2000. And at one time when you got off the ride, the test dummies were actual characters. They had like people in suits that were test dummies, which was pretty cool.
Okay, so I guess to reiterate, I guess in a different way, I think that with this was one of the first interactive queues. It's probably a better way to go forward because you're actually interacting with the ride that you're about to be riding on.
That is one of the good things. Mine is always, I always go straight power. That is a cool aspect, and I like the little bit of competition aspect, and kind of, it's also fun for the kids to be able to design their own vehicle. So rounding out, let's go to the other side of Future World and talk about, I guess mainly Soarin'. I'd like to get Liz's thoughts on Soarin'.
Yeah, so conveniently, I've done a similar ride to Soarin' actually with Ed before. So we did it in the Mall of America, so that kind of simulation. So for me, it wasn't a new experience. I mean, I enjoyed it when I did it in the Mall of America, but for me, it wasn't like anything new. But I definitely love the feeling of like you're sitting there, you feel the platform, you know, the seats that are holding you kind of move up. You can feel the wind. Like, I really definitely love that aspect of like bringing that kind of 4D experience to the ride.
It is. It's one of my favorite attractions at Epcot. I could ride it over and over. Again, I don't know. I'm a little. I look back to the original Soarin' and kind of think, man, that one was pretty good. But I kind of like this one too. But the original one kind of has some nostalgia to it. Quinn, what was your? You prefer this one or you prefer the original?
No, I agree with you. I do prefer the original. I don't. Other than, I guess, the idea of moving on, this is the new iteration of the ride. I don't see why they can't have both versions of the ride. Treat it like the orange and green sides of Mission Space, perhaps, you know.
I mean, the way it's set up as a film, they certainly, there's no reason why they couldn't change that out. You know, there's three theaters there, too. So they could have two play in one movie and another one, you know, the third play in the other movie. And it's just kind of luck of the draw what you get, I guess. Melissa, thoughts on Soarin'?
I actually prefer the new iteration only because I think it fits for Walt Disney World and being near World Showcase and going around the world. But I am disappointed in the, I don't know, CGI effects and that stuff starts to curve. So I don't know if Liz, we picked up the Eiffel Tower isn't very straight.
Oh, yeah.
Depends on where you're sitting, though. I mean, it just depends on where you're sitting. If you have a center seat,
and
you don't get
that.
That's
the sad part.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of sad that you don't get the same experience in any seat. It really, like, I make sure that when we go do that, we ask for, you know, center, front row center.
I do that if I'm with somebody who probably won't come back to the park. I mean, it may be a once in a lifetime trip or it's their first one. We've definitely asked those cast members and they've been, unless the line is out the door and it's just like Christmas Day, they've been very accommodating to allow us to wait our turn, you know, let a couple families go ahead and then put us in that middle row.
As much as I love some of the other attractions in Epcot, in the front of Epcot, like Living with the Land and Figment. In the interest of time, let's move to World Showcase. Anything cool there that you guys did or ate or drank and just was awed by?
I was in my Disney nerdness. I was like, oh, let's try to get some of the key ones away. So we returned after our break and we're like, okay, let's do the Canada show. And it ended up being closed because they were getting ready for Food and Wine Festival. So that was a really big bummer.
I just saw pictures today that they, you know, because they're using that space as a booth for the Food and Wine. It's the Appleseed Orchid, I believe.
So that means it's closed for all Food and Wine as well?
Yep, I believe so.
We went on the boat ride in Mexico. We saw the Reflections of China show, which I hadn't seen in a while. I think Are they planning on making changes to that movie?
They are.
Okay. So I guess it's good that we were able to see it. We saw The American Adventure.
Well, one of my favorites.
We didn't get to too many food and drinks around the show world, but I think the one big thing that we did was we were able to get fish and chips in England, which might seem minor, but I think during this time between the Flower and Garden Festival and the Food and Wine Festival, they were offering a additional chicken and mushroom pastry kind of dish.
Interesting.
Which
super good.
It was really good, but it was specifically nostalgic for me because when I studied abroad in England a few years ago, the student center at the university I was at had a shop of just different types of these types of pastries. So,
oh, that's cool.
I kind of got to relive my school days.
And when you said you got fish and chips in the UK, did you guys eat inside the Rose and Crown, or you ate at the Yorkshire? The little stand outside.
It's the separate stand. It only has like outdoor seating.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And we ended up eating, which was kind of odd because we were really kind of later at night. And I feel like people didn't realize that there were additional tables like behind.
Oh, yeah. By the water.
But back there. Yeah. So we ate back there and that was really nice.
Now, were the fireworks going on during your visit?
We kind of just missed them, I guess, or didn't want to stay. We didn't get to see them, unfortunately, because I probably didn't find out until afterwards that they actually were going on.
You know, I like the fireworks there. It's no Illuminations. Epcot Forever is okay, but it wouldn't be a must do in my opinion. It's just a temporary show until they came out with the new one in October, and you can tell it's kind of a temporary show, unfortunately, because it doesn't just have all the grandeur that most of their fireworks shows do.
I've seen what they're planning for the new show, and it looks pretty impressive.
It looks intense. I'm excited. I'll be there October 1st to catch the debut of it, and I'm pretty excited about that. So day two, where'd you guys head?
So day two was the Magic Kingdom.
Okay.
Yeah, so we were able to rope drop for Seven Dwarfs Mine Train that day. So we made sure to go on that. We got pretty lucky with our placement because when they stopped us at Mad Hatter Tea Ride, but we were pretty close to the front of the group.
That's good.
And then after that, we kind of snaked our way through Fantasyland. We hit the Winnie the Pooh ride and Small World and Haunted Mansion. Yeah, by the time we got to Haunted Mansion, the line times are kind of ramping up. So we were on that line for about half an hour, I think.
Were they doing the pre-show for Haunted Mansion?
They were.
Yes. So the stretching room was on?
Mm-hmm.
That's another thing that just recently, I mean, very recently had just come back. So you guys lucked out for that because, especially with Liz being her first time, you know, it's my favorite attraction and it's not quite the same without the stretching room.
Yeah.
What were the lines in general like for Magic Kingdom?
I think it depended on the time of day because that was the day there was a big thunderstorm in the area. So Pirates was down most of the day, if not all day. Most of the rides were getting to that 70, 80 minute amount. So the big mountains were getting there. Peter Pan's flight was there. Haunted Mansion, Small World, Winnie the Pooh were getting about 45.
We were pretty strategic, I would say, with checking the ride times and the wait times. So like Quinn was saying, like the mountain, you know, the big three mountain, their lines are pretty long. So we kind of ended up even waiting to go on Space Mountain until like right after the fireworks ended.
That's a good strategy.
Yeah, I think we did wait about 50 to 60 minutes for Splash Mountain, but really just because I knew that it probably wouldn't get any shorter and it could only get longer. And at that point, I just wanted to make sure that we could get on it.
And that's another one that's going to be gone away. So
I know it's a controversial opinion on whether or not it's good that it's going away. I'm happy to see change in a general sense. I understand nostalgia, so I was still happy to see the original ride. before they make the changes.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great ride. Regardless of the history, I mean, I understand why the change, but it doesn't take away from the attraction. And I think they've done a great job of separating the attraction from the history of the movie and kind of let the attraction stand on its own. But yeah, it's one of the better rides in Magic Kingdom. It's been a great ride for years. So yeah, for sure. I'm okay with them changing it, but it's not bad that you got to see it and Liz got to see it in its original form before they change it.
Mm-hmm. The Jungle Cruise was long all day or closed if it was during the thunderstorm. So we didn't get to go on that. Pirates up here has had issues in the last week or so in a general sense. So we kind of were there during the beginning of those problems.
Tiki Room?
We did the Tiki Room, yes.
Yeah, I like the Tiki Room. We are strategically placed as close to one of the walls as you could be, conveniently next to one of the Tiki heads. So,
when it started moving its mouth, it kind of freaked you out a little bit.
Yeah, exactly. Because Quinn was like, look, and I was like, what? And it was like moving and it was all lit up and everything. I enjoyed that. I thought of it. That was super cool.
You know, and as a Disney nerd, there's only a handful of attractions in Magic Kingdom that, you know, Walt Disney actually like had his hands on in the Tiki Room and Carousel of Progress and Small World are three of them. And they carry his name because of it. That's why they're called Walt Disney, you know, Enchanted Tiki Room and Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress. So I'm assuming you guys did Carousel of Progress.
We did. It started raining to eventual downpour when we were getting onto it, so we were kind of rushing.
Optimal timing.
Yes.
It's good.
Yes, it was fun.
You liked it?
Oh yeah, I thought it was cool. I feel like I saw my parents' dinner plates in one of the rooms that I was sitting through. I'm like, oh, that looks familiar. But yeah, I thought it was interesting how in the very last, like, kind of modern, as close to modern day as you could, they had like the voice command kitchen, and I was like, ah, that was a good part of the storyline.
They probably could go back and update. The problem with that is, and you know, that's been the one of the things, and they talk about that on one of the tours we went on, is that Future World is so hard to just maintain because it just catches up so quick. They can put the stuff out there and it's like, this is the future, but then it catches up and then you got to scrap it all. So I think they've reserved it now to what, like, this idea of what Future World was and not necessarily actual future.
Mm-hmm. I think that's fine. I would like to see more decades as we now have lived them, because it stops in the 60s, I think, or even the 50s, as late as it goes.
Yeah, I think the 50s.
I would like to see 70s, 80s, or 90s represented as well.
Speaking of kitchens, what did you all enjoy for food and drink while at Magic Kingdom?
Oh, so luckily enough, that was the day we had our big dining reservation. So we ate at the Skipper Canteen, which was lucky because I think it was either pouring or near the end of the rain when we were getting ready to sit for our reservation. But we really enjoyed it. We didn't really get too much food afterwards because we were just so full.
What did you guys have?
I had the suey pork.
I love it. That's my favorite. My personal favorite.
Yeah, and then I had the noodles, and I read somewhere that you could, like, add a different meat to them, so I think I added steak.
Yeah, I think you substituted the tofu with chicken.
Yeah, I got chicken and steak on it, and that was a really good, like, it didn't feel necessarily that you were eating, like, something like fried food, but it felt like real food, if that makes sense.
Sure.
So we did not eat dinner that night. We were we were totally full by the end of that.
Yeah, we love it there, and I'll tell you, you could go there. Yeah, I could go there and just eat appetisers. It's got some of the best appetizers anywhere.
We got falafel.
Falafel's good. The cachapas are good. They had
cheesy bites.
Yeah, they had that one.
That was on the menu.
It was
at least the shortened menu they have for right now.
Yeah, they've been having that for the Brazilian cheese bread, which is. I don't know if they don't call it Brazilian. They just call it cheese bread, but it's almost identical to the cheese bread that they have in Brazil for Food and Wine. It's also delicious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much. I like the sauce that came with that cheese bread.
Yes, it was like a chimichurri.
And I don't think we got desserts because we were planning on getting Dole Whip when we came back from the hotel after our break. So we kept it to the appetizers and main course.
Yeah, we had all our snacks during the fireworks. So the Dole Whip, the popcorn, and we did the,
we brought the popcorn bucket that my dad brought.
Nice.
He had it laying around from like 2 years ago. He's like, I'm pretty sure it's still good. And it was.
Yeah, they don't get it. They don't really question it. I don't think they really care. I think they're still making money at $2 for popcorn. Dole Whip or Dole Whip float?
It was the float because it had the pineapple, I think, the pineapple juice at the bottom.
Oh, yeah. That's my favorite, pineapple, the float.
Yeah.
It was good. It was very good.
It was one of those we had to get it so that Liz could experience it kind of things.
Yeah. Yep. We did that in May. We didn't do it in Magic Kingdom. We went to the Poly with my son and his girlfriend and got a Dole Whip. Well, they got Dole Whips. I got a Dole Whip float. Liz, what was your first impression like when you came through the entrance and you kind of make that turn in Town Square and you get that first look down the street to the castle?
The castle is definitely very cool. I feel like I had seen photos of it, like just the castle, but not the road leading up to it. So I know we had watched the Netflix special that talked a little bit about how all the hidden details that are in that.
It might have been Disney Plus, right?
Could
yeah.
be. Yeah.
Or, yeah. Netflix, yeah. It was the Imagination, the Imagineering special that they had when Disney Plus started.
Yep.
And they were airing it.
Yeah. So as we were walking down, like Quinn was saying, oh, smell everything, look at everything. It was definitely a really cool experience. I felt like, what were we running towards? We were running towards the
Mine Train.
Seven Dwarfs.
Yeah. So we didn't, I felt like we spent more time when we were looking at everything once we were doing like the photo pass stuff.
Yeah. I mean,
so you saw all of our photos.
Yeah. So I did. I had to download them all and send them to Quinn.
Yeah. Thank you again.
No worries. By the way, I was just, before I came back here to record, my wife was watching Disney Plus and she's been watching the Animal Kingdom show. Yeah, Josh Gad narrates it, but it's not just about theme parks. It's about all the animals that they take care of at Animal Kingdom. So it's more behind the scenes and the animals that they take care of and surgeries and how, you know, this one gets sick. And it's really cool. It's like one of those. There's another show on one of the streaming services, like about the Tampa Zoo, that they do kind of the same, like a lot of behind the scenes stuff. It's real cool.
Now that you've been to Animal Kingdom and you can see a lot of the behind the stage areas and the work that they put into these animals, definitely recommend that one. And I think the Imagineering one that you were talking about is the Leslie Iwerks Imagineering that premiered. Yeah, right when Disney Plus came out.
Yeah, now there's also a series, The Imagineering Story, on Disney Plus, which is also great. And then they're about to also come out with a series that's all about the attractions. It's going to go behind the scenes and kind of tell the story of all the attractions. And I think The Rock is part of that, and along with a couple other people. Day three, where'd you guys go?
So day three was Disney's Hollywood Studios. So we rope drop Smuggler's Run. And we, like we said earlier, we were in that, virtual queue first thing in the morning.
We knew we were going to come back to the Star Wars land, so we kind of stuck around a little bit, not too much. We knew we were going to be back.
What'd you guys get on Smuggler's Run?
We were engineers.
What were you? Had you done that before, Quinn?
I haven't done this. No. A lot of the new stuff that just came to Disney Hollywood Studios arrived after last time I went.
Okay.
So this was all new for me too.
What about Toy Story Land?
I was there for Toy Story Land. We didn't do too much in Toy Story Land. We walked through, so we got to see everything. But after rope dropping the Smuggler's Run, we weren't going to go and get online for the Slinky Dog Coaster.
Yeah. Yep. I agree with you.
Were you able to make it to Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railroad?
Yes. We were able to do that later in the day. We did wait the full length of the line, I guess. So that was all outside, and it was sunny and hot. So it was a bit unpleasant, but but I think it was at least a bit worthwhile for the ride, how great it is.
So if I gave you the option to keep it the way it is or go back, and Liz is not going to understand this, but go back to the great movie ride, what would you do?
I like the ride. I think that they could have, I guess, made more updates to the great movie ride that were more for more recent movies and have put the Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway somewhere else. Having the change already been made, I probably would say it's okay staying. There's a lot of stuff that's already been phased out of the memories for Disney Hollywood Studios. Because we lost the backlot tour and Lights, Motor, Action. I was thinking when we were getting ready for the trip, I was thinking about where Star Wars Land is, and I remember the Osborne family lights, and I was like, wow, I can't believe I actually remember that was a thing. It's sad to see these rides go, but I'm excited for the new rides that replace them.
Yeah, it's tough, but it's a trade-off, right? So, did you go into the market in Galaxy's Edge?
Yeah, no, we walked through it a little bit. We didn't hang around too much. It was a bit crowded, and we were kind of in a rush because we were trying to cancel my dad's droid appointment, which we were able to do. But that was that area that had all those shops on the side. And we were walking through, and we found a cast member, and we asked him. He's like, oh, you can go this way. Yeah.
So in that area right outside the toy store, there's, like, on the wall, there's these three speeders, like speeder bikes. And one of them has three letters in Arabic. And if you translate it, it's LMA, because that's where Lights, Motors, Action was.
That's nice.
Yeah. So it's a little Easter egg.
I like it when they at least acknowledge the Easter eggs and like what was there before. Yep. You know, that's always good to see.
So you ended up not building a droid?
We did not build a droid, which is okay. I think it would have been a lot better experience if my dad was there with us.
Yeah, for sure.
Going through with him.
He would really dig it. I just did it in May with Kim. Kim wanted to build one, so since I have the lightsaber, she wanted her droid, so we built a BB unit in May, and it's a cool experience. Again, it's kind of like the lightsaber. It's like, I mean, the lightsaber is cool and all, but the experience is really like the whole going through and building it and the way they, everything, the whole thing is just awesome. That's what really makes it worth it. Did you guys do Tower of Terror and Rock and Roller Coaster?
We did. Those were definitely my two, like, favorite rides in the park. So I'm a huge, like, roller coaster person, so I really like the Rock and Roller Coaster. And then the Tower of Terror, I like that too, because we're conveniently also placed in the front row for that ride. That's so awesome. I felt like we got a really good experience seeing, like, you know, the drops and the levels. And when he said the ride dropped, I wasn't expecting it to be that forceful. I don't know what I was thinking, but I
warned you about the randomization, at least, right?
Yeah. And it actually, like, it does more than drop, right? Like, it shoots you down, basically. So it's more than it's more than just gravity. Did they do the pre-show for that? Did they have you in the library and watch the film?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, I think they brought back most pre-shows at this point.
So that's really good, too, because
this and for Rock and Roller Coaster as well.
Yeah. That's really good too, because like when we went, they didn't have the you just walked through that room, and like for me it didn't really matter, but like for my son's girlfriend, she had never been, and she didn't really know Twilight Zone really well. I mean, she's young like you guys, so you know, but that room kind of sets the story of what's going on and why things are happening the way they're happening. So
It would have been cool, and I'm trying to imagine this, like, oh, if I'm going through the ride and they don't have the pre-show, like, it would have been cool if they had somewhere in the app where they had the pre-show's video available to look.
The second time we wrote it, I pulled it up on YouTube and had her watch it on YouTube.
Yeah, because they already have the location, like, if you have the location enabled while you're not in the app, or if you have it in the app, they know that you're at that ride.
That's a great idea.
Either send you a push notification or just have it pop up on your home screen specifically to be like, oh, Tower of Terror, a bit spooky. Here's here's a video. Yeah.
Have you guys seen the Tower of Terror movie?
I knew there was one. I have not. I think I know about it, though.
Melissa?
Long time ago. It's Kirsten Dunst, right?
Kirsten Dunst and... oh God,
he's from Monk.
Gutenberg. Steve Gutenberg.
Right?
No.
Yeah.
No, Steve Gutenberg. He's not from Monk. That's Tony Shalhoub. Steve Gutenberg and a young Kirsten Dunst. You can pick up the DVD, Quinn, on Amazon. It's actually like a 3-pack that comes with Country Bears. It's a 4-pack. Comes with Country Bears, the movie, the Haunted Mansion movie, Mr. Toad, and Ichabod, and then Tower of Terror
with Eddie Murphy.
Yes.
Are they on Disney Plus?
I don't think Tower of Terror is. Tower of Terror was like a made for Disney Channel movie.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's Disney Channel.
It was made.
Tambourine was as well.
Oh, that's
awesome. Yeah. They had two, I think.
Well, now you know what you're getting for Christmas.
Yeah, so you can get it like for $8 on Amazon. The 4-pack of those movies. I've bought them multiple. I bought multiple times. Like I think I bought them for Lisa because like her kids had never seen. And I'm like, I ordered it and sent it to him because I'm like, you go on Tower of Terror all the time, you got to see the movie. And they actually filmed that movie at the Tower of Terror in Hollywood Studios. So Liz may not know that, but Liz may not
know that.
Well, Liz may not know that at one time that was a working studio.
I knew about the movies and I was telling Liz that. I think it was another time when we were watching a trailer for the Jungle Cruise about how it's like, well, they might reference the Jungle Cruise, but the movie is trying to be its own thing, a lot like Pirates of the Caribbean.
Oh, yeah. The Tower of Terror thing was more of a promotion, I think. The Tower of Terror made for Disney Channel. It's kind of like goes along the lines of actual the ride. So it's more all about the ride. So it's cute and it's kind of corny, but... it's worth watching. It's worth watching. I'd watch it again. It's better than the Eddie Murphy Haunted Mansion movie.
Yes. Great.
And I'm a Eddie Murphy fan, but that movie is just not very good. So, anything else in Hollywood Studios?
So I know my dad suggested going to any of the restaurants in the Star Wars land, but we actually found more likable food at the ABC Commissary, which I guess is just a testament to show that they're diversifying the selections at the other restaurants as well. So
yeah,
it's
are.
Just burgers and chicken fingers. It's a good mix.
I agree.
Yeah. And we did mobile ordering for literally almost anything.
Almost everything. Okay.
Yeah.
And then the next day, I'm guessing was Animal Kingdom.
Correct. I do want to mention that.
Okay.
Usually, we would take a break at the hotel, go back to the same park, but we pretty much got through all of Hollywood Studios, or at least what we wanted to get through. So we went to Disney Springs that night.
Yeah.
Which was pretty good because I didn't think we'd have time to go, but we were able to make time then. So I don't think they added anything new on my end in terms of experience. But we were able to do some shopping for gifts, and then we were able to we ate at Deluxe Burger at my dad's recommendation.
I've been to Deluxe Burger. I've never eaten there. Next time, talk to me and I'll give you better recommendations.
Oh no, it was good.
It was so good though.
I know, and a lot of people like it. I would tell you if I was given Melissa, if you were given a recommendation of a quick service place to eat at Disney Springs, what would your recommendation be?
Oh, quick service?
Mine would be Polite Pig. Hands down, Polite Pig is.
Yeah. I guess I didn't even think of that as a quick service because they have to put tables outside. But
it's kind of a pseudo quick service because you order at the counter, but then they bring it to your table.
I can get on board with that being quick service. Yep.
Yeah. But I mean, you walk in and you order at the counter. They deliver it to you, but you order at the counter. So it's oh my God, it's so good. That was the last thing me and Kim ate.
Yeah, Quinn's dad suggested that
Oh, he suggested it. Yeah. So
he suggested that one. The Deluxe Burger was more so because it was later at night.
Yeah. Nothing wrong with Deluxe Burger. I was given I was giving Ed a hard time in his absence.
They had a Black Widow burger as the specialty at Deluxe Burger.
Oh,
and it was this like spicy burger. It had a black bun, and they put a little pepper in the Black Widow belt buckle shape on the top of the bun.
That's cool.
Yeah.
And they got like 10 different dipping sauces or something like that for the fries?
Yeah. They have so many different types of ranches or chipotle sauces or mayos. Yeah.
The last trip I did, we ate at Polite Pig, which I love. But the one before that, we ate like Blaze Pizza, which was amazing. And we have one in New Orleans.
Yeah,
we're familiar with Blaze. They have it in near Drexel's campus. So Blaze was not on the top of our list to try it.
But you know, we have one here in New Orleans. But I've never been to the one in New Orleans. So we were just looking for something kind of familiar and quick. You know.
Yeah.
It's okay. It's good pizza. But it was just a bit, it was funny to see it and be like, we could get this on campus. I don't want to go here.
But with that being said, Deluxe Burgers are chain. We don't have one here, but they have Deluxe Burgers other places. So similar to Blaze, a lot of those places are chains.
I'd be interested in seeing Disney bring In-N-Out or Whataburger to Disney Springs.
Oh, that God. If they had a Whataburger, I would never leave. I would just eat there every day.
Exactly, yeah.
All right. Anything else, Disney Springs? Did you guys get any cool drinks or anything like that in Springs?
We got a milkshake at Deluxe Burger as well.
Nice.
We got the chocolate s'mores one.
That's cool.
And then the only other notable thing I would say is that we were able to do mobile checkout at the Wonderful World of Disney shop.
Oh, so, that's new.
Yeah, that's new. So we were just piling on different things that we were getting, and I scanned them all, and then that's how you check out. We did have to wrap everything ourselves, so we had a bunch of mugs that we had to wrap.
Interesting. The only thing else I would tell you to put on your list there for the next time you guys go is to go do Characters in Flight. That's the big helium balloon.
Oh, I think I saw an advertisement for that in the restroom.
If it's windy, if it's windy or there's lightning in the area, they won't run it. So it may have not been gone up when you guys were there. But it's cool. I've done it once, and I can't get my wife to do it, but I've done it once, and it was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Quinn has a fear of heights, so I don't know.
I'm not crazy about heights either. But you're kind of contained in like this cage. Like you can walk around, but you're kind of contained. So it was okay. It wasn't like, I'm not crazy about heights either, but it wasn't terrible. Also, if you know you're going to head down, here's a good tip that you can sometimes find Groupons for the Characters in Flight. Because it's a separate company. It's Aerofile is the company. And then the next day you guys went to Animal Kingdom.
Yes, that was our last day. We still got up insanely early, and we did rope drop for Flight of Passage.
It didn't feel like it because we kind of just got on the line right away, but we were there before the park was supposed to open, so I'm still counting it as rope drop.
Gotcha. Yeah, they end up opening that park early a lot because they let people in. Instead of piling them up at the gate, they let them into the park where they can start queuing up at the attraction. Flight of Passage, you've done it before, right, Quinn?
Yeah, I was lucky enough to do it on our last trip, so that was not new to me, but it's still fun every time. But
yeah. Liz, what'd you think about that one?
I mean, I liked Avatar the movie to begin with, so I enjoyed the storyline, but then actually being, like, you sit down, they tell you to lean forward, and then you started feeling things like on your legs and your back, and I was like, oh wow, this is really cool. I wasn't expecting that. Like I didn't really know why they, at the time I was like, why are they telling me to lean forward and like make sure I'm up and close with this like bike seat thing? But I definitely enjoyed it. I can't remember, did they spray water?
A little bit of mist.
I don't know. I definitely would have wanted to do that ride again, but that, like, I think that one had an insanely long, like,
it
time.
It usually does. Yeah.
It was 155 minutes at one point during the day. And it was like, we're only going to do this once. And even like we went as early as we could that morning and we still had to wait in line a really long time. So
did y'all do Navi? Did y'all do the other attraction in Pandora and the Navi River Journey?
We should have. I thought the line, the wait time would stay low, but it just kept rising. So we'll definitely make sure to do it next time.
I mean, it's nice. It's definitely not. It's not something I'd wait in the line for. Not too long, for sure.
Yeah.
Well, it was like 10 or 15 minutes. And I was like, Quinn, should we do this? It's only like 10 minutes. Yes. And he was like, no, we have to go to Everest. That was a good ride.
Yeah, I don't know what the deal is with Everest, though. It seems like that line, it seems like it consistently has short wait times. Navi River gets longer wait times than Everest for whatever reason. I don't think it's a better ride by any means.
Everest, the benefit is a single rider. So you can, in general, it's 1 minute wait per person ahead of you in the single rider. So you always have that option as long as you don't mind riding with somebody else. And then even the main ride just moves quickly in general. So yeah, definitely that's a good one to hit up too. Everest is one of my favorite rides, Everest and Tower of Terror. So I don't blame Quinn for sending you over there if the line looked good.
It was good. We rode it twice. The first time we rode it together and we were in the front car and we got to the, you know, that kind of climax of the ride. And I was like, oh my God, wait, this ride goes backwards?
And I was like, oh yeah, I forgot to mention that.
Good job. Quinn.
So it was kind of, that was interesting. But then we, like Melissa said, we did the single rider the second time. That was pretty fast as well. We didn't have to wait too long, I felt like.
You guys do safari?
We did. I think we did it a bit later in the day. So,
I guess it was like around 11 maybe?
Yeah.
It was hot.
We did Cali River Rapids first. So we did that after Everest.
I don't do Cali River Rapids until I'm ready to go. I haven't done it in years. I did it this past trip because, you know, both of my kids were there with their significant others, and it was my son's girlfriend had never been. And as soon as we got to the spot where you're about to go down the hill, I mean, we're lined up where I'm on one side of a gap and my son's on the other side of the gap, and we're about to go down the hill, and I'm like, we're about to get it. We're going to get soaked. And I mean, my socks were wet. I mean, my underwear was wet. I mean, like, I was completely soaked. Back to the room.
It was so hot that day.
We didn't care.
It was kind of really welcome.
It was so hot. Yeah. Like, it was ridiculous. Like, when we got off, I wanted to go again because I was like, I didn't get wet enough. I wanted to go again.
I feel like it's all or nothing. It just depends on where you're sitting when that thing spins around and stops and it's going down that hill. Like, if you're either in a terrible spot or you're going to be okay. And me and my son were in a terrible, like, I had water in my ear. Like, it was, yeah, like, it just blasted us.
We got semi-terrible.
We were with a whole group of family, and Quinn and I were the two odd man out. And it was one of the sets in their party. They went down backwards, and Quinn and I were to their immediate right. So we still got wet.
And they do a good job of having, like, the waters, like the sprinklers. It's like, oh, the elephant at the end of the ride, just in case you didn't get wet, you got wet.
Yeah, you're gonna get you. Yep. They used to be on the bridge. There used to be cannons that people could direct them and shoot certain people.
When we were standing in line, Quinn was saying, like, we brought a little baggie for, like, electronics, so that was fine. But Quinn was, we were walking up, he's like, oh, there used to be this thing where you kind of just
leave in the middle.
Yeah, but now you hold it with you. So I feel like more people should be aware of
that. I don't know why I guess because they don't want everybody's stuff touching, that they took it out because of COVID, I guess. But yeah, there used to be like plastic tops in the very center. You just set your stuff in there and close it. That was another thing. Yeah, I had my feet on the bar and I sat my backpack like on top of my feet But it didn't matter. We just got soaked, so it didn't matter.
For us, they were telling us to, everyone had to wear it on their chest as you were getting on the ride. They had you flip all your backpacks forward.
Interesting.
But after that, we got in line for Safari. We waited a good hour for that.
Really?
Uh-huh. It was a Saturday, so I imagine it was just long waits in general.
Yeah.
Because we waited about 25 minutes on Cali River Rapids, and after that, I don't think it got lower than 45 minutes.
We didn't see too many animals on the safari. We saw some, but
I think we saw a good amount. We might not have seen a lot, but they were so close to the car.
Okay. Yeah. I give you that. Okay. I wanted to see the lions, so
they're the most fickle. They're the most hit or miss, the lions. Especially in the middle of, when it gets to the middle of the day and it's hot out. They just kind of bed down and you don't really see them very well.
So, Liz, kind of rounding out the trip, this was your first experience there. What was your favorite park that you visited?
I think about it in terms of, like, attractions. I feel like I would definitely go back to Hollywood Studios more so than any of the other ones, just because I felt like, well, maybe. I guess that's depending on, like, Rise of the Resistance in the future. Like, if you can still get on that, and then we could still do like the Tower of Terror and the Rock and Roller Coaster. Like, if I could probably ride those three rides the whole day, I'd probably be pretty fine. I did like that aspect. I'm trying to think in terms of like there wasn't really any like shows though in that one. I did like Animal Kingdom though, for the fact that it did have like the Lion King show and the bird show. I really enjoyed the I forget what they call the bird show, but I really did like the bird show.
Well, they're doing us. I don't think they're doing the whole show. It used to be up, and it used to be up story to it. Now I think they're kind of just reverted back to the characters or birds in flight.
That's what it was, because it didn't even have. I remember. I don't think I ever experienced the up integrated show.
Yeah,
I had the general one where it's just the two ornithologists back and forth to each other. I know the one iteration where they had the tour guide, they had the tour guide who was scared of of birds.
Yeah.
But then he learns to love birds. I remember that too.
That was great.
But we got the one, but we got the fun one. We got the one that caused an argument between me and Quinn, because we had two guides, and the one bird stole the mic off the other guy, the guide. And I thought it was, like, legit, like, oh, my gosh, he actually stole this guy's, like, mic cable. And Quinn's like, no, it's part of the show. And I'm like,
yeah,
are you serious? Like, yeah. Disney plans this stuff.
And then later when we were talking to my dad about it, he's like, no, that's part of the show.
Yeah, for sure.
And he was just going through, oh yeah, the part where the crow takes the mic cable, yeah, that's part of the show.
And unfortunately, Liz, I think you still missed the best show at Animal Kingdom, which is Finding Nemo the musical, which they have not brought back.
Yeah,
they haven't brought that back yet, but it's a Broadway quality musical, so it's really, really good.
Yeah, I imagine if we were to have done it, she would have been like, oh, that's all those songs you randomly sing.
Which is, we did get some of those, though. On the way back, Quinn has a playlist of Disney theme music. So I was able to guess some of them. I was like, oh, this is what ride this is from. Okay.
It's interesting, too, because I had seen the attraction in Disney World so many times that I always kind of thought it's like some of those songs were in Nemo, the movie, and none of them are. There's no music, there's no songs in Nemo, the movie.
So we did do the Lion King show though,
and that's a different. They shortened that too because they don't have the little acrobatic monkeys in it.
Yeah, they didn't have
monkeys.
Yeah, they used to have like the
tumble monkeys.
They had a trampoline in the center, and you can kind of still see the platform that they would have taken the mat away from for trampoline.
Yeah.
And they would have had the poles for the like high, not the high beam, but you know how in the gymnastics they have
the trapeze.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly. Okay. And they also didn't do, I guess, the whole each section was represented by a different animal. So either the giraffe, the elephant, Simba, or Pumbaa.
Yeah.
They didn't really have that. They only separated the audience when they were doing The Lion Sleeps Tonight.
Gotcha.
Either swaying or clapping along.
I guess they don't want everybody yelling, which makes sense. All right, guys. Well, it sounds like you had a fantastic trip. It sounds like you need to go back, and sounds like you may have missed a few things, but that's what keeps us going back. I know it's going to be interesting. I know Liz brought up kind of the ride vehicle for Flight of Passage, which I think is going to be interesting because I think the Tron ride vehicle is going to be very similar to that, except it is a roller coaster.
So you're gonna be
you're gonna be like on a bike, but on a roller coaster. That's kind of awesome. Between that and Guardians of the Galaxy and Ratatouille, like all these great things coming, Harmonious. So have to get you guys down there for a Disney Nerds podcast meetup trip in the future.
Maybe we'll see.
Well, thank you guys for joining us, Melissa. Thank you for helping me out.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It was nice to hear about your trip, Quinn and Liz. As Jimmy said in the beginning, we can live vicariously through you all when we can't get to the parks.
Let me know if you want to see their pictures, Melissa. I have them.
All of them.
All of them.
It was a challenge. It was the challenge. We did literally every single photo pass.
I'm like, oh my God, how about this? I thought they were only there for like 4 days. There's like 135 pictures. That's fun though. We've done that on trips before too. Like every time we see a photo pass photographer, we're like, yep, let's stop and get a picture. So that's great. So thank you guys again. Have a wonderful night, and we'll see you all soon. For Melissa, Quinn, and Liz, this is Jimmy, and we will see you later. Quaharini.
TTFM. Ta-ta for now.
Thanks for having us.
Like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory. Mortals pay a token fee, rest in